What's up, guys? Today we are going to work on our Python backdoor. So we've learned enough so far of Python in order to execute this process. Now there is some code in here that we haven't touched on yet, but it's very simple and straightforward. So I'll explain that. So let's just go ahead and dive right in. All right, so this is our backdoor right here. So basically what we're doing is we're creating a reverse shell to our computer. So here's a scenario. You have a victim computer and you have your attack computer. You want to send a shell from the victim computer to your attack computer. That way you have a shell on your local box. So this program is going to facilitate that. This is basically a backdoor program that you can run on any Windows or Linux system, really any operating system that'll run Python. Once you execute this script, it will then make a reverse shell back to your system, and from there you're able to execute commands once you have provided the appropriate credentials. So before we see this in action, let's go ahead and run through the code. So starting at the very top, we have to import some libraries here. The first one is subprocess. This is going to allow us to basically execute a process from within inside our Python script. And this is how we'll facilitate the execution of commands. Next, we have to import the socket library. This allows us to work with and manipulate socket data. And this is how you communicate via the internet from a programming standpoint. You use sockets. All right, now we need to create some initialization variables. The first one is our host, and this is going to be the IP address of your attack computer. So this is the IP that you want the reverse shell to go to. This is the port that the attack computer will be listening on. And this is obviously a password which will be used to protect your backdoor so other people can't connect to it and have access to your victim computer. All right, next we need a couple of routines, functions, methods. The first one is the login method, and this is going to check a user who connects their password to see if it's valid or not. If the password is valid, it will then drop them to a shell where they can execute commands. If the password is invalid, it will ask them for the password again. So first thing first, we need to set a global variable for S, which we use down here. We'll get to that in a second, but that's why we're setting this global variable. That way we can access our sockets from anywhere inside our application. Next, this line of code is going to send the text to the user login, and this is basically prompting the user to enter their password. This line of code will basically take whatever the user types in and store it inside the PWD variable. Next, we have our if statement, and this line of code will compare our password right here with the password that the user typed in. Now, we have to add this dot strip, and what this does is this will trim any white spaces from what the user typed. Because with when the sockets are coming in, there's some trailing spaces on there, and if you compare that with your text, it's not going to be the same, and you're going to get an invalid password even though you typed in the correct password. So it's important that you have this call this strip function. That way it trims off any spaces. And basically it's saying if the password is not correct, we're going to send them back to the login routine. So basically it's just going to start this process all over. If they do enter the correct password, we're going to drop them to a prompt. And then we're going to execute the shell method. The shell method basically consists of a while loop that contains all of the following code. So this will run for infinity. It will not stop until told to stop. So the first line we need to do is we need to take whatever data that the user has typed and store that into a variable. And that's what we do right here. So we receive any data and then we store it into the data variable. The next line of code, this is our close code. So basically it's saying if the user typed this text, I want you to break the while loop and that will end the program. So if a user types colon kill from the command prompt, that will close out the program. So this is our close clause right here. If that's not the case, then the user must want to execute a man. So we will then send this input off to our subprocess and execute that. So this first line of code here is creating this subprocess. It's basically saying, hey, Python, I know that I'm running a program right now, but I actually want to run a second program inside my Python program. So that's what we're doing here. So we're creating a new subprocess. And then we're opening that subprocess. And what are we opening? Well, we're opening a command. And where are we getting that command? Well, we're getting it from the socket data that the user types in. And we're storing that inside the data variable. So our first command option is going to be data, because that's going to be the command that the user wants to issue. Next is whether or not we're executing via shell, we're going to tell it to true. And then lastly, we're going to configure our standard output, our errors, and standard input. So this will basically take our subprocess and store the standard output, the errors, and the input. That way we are able to access them and use them as we see fit. And you'll see that on the next line. So now we have executed our subprocess. And now we want the output because a user typed a command. So they're expecting something back from the server. So now that since we've executed this, we now have information available. Our standard out will contain whatever that command outputted in the process. So we basically access our subprocess, then we access the standard output, and then we execute the read function in order to read what's inside the standard output. Same thing for errors. So all we're doing is just adding any errors that we may get into our output variable. Right now, output stores whatever the output was of our command. So now what we're going to do is we're going to take that output and we're going to send it to the socket. So that's going to send it back to the user so they can see what happened with the command they typed. And then lastly, we're just going to put them right back at a prompt so they can execute another command. And that's it for the shell routine. And lastly, this is actually the start of our script. This is where the script will begin. And the first thing we do is we initialize our socket. And we do that with this simple command. This is basically saying we're wanting to make internet sockets and we're going to access them via a stream. Once you have that set, our S variable now contains our socket and now we can make a connection. And we do that right here. So the connect function allows you to make a socket connection to a remote host. So we've already configured our host and our port at the top of our script. So we simply pass in this IP port as an object. That's why it's inside the both sets. So that will make a connection. And if that is all good and well and successful, it will then execute our login routine. So basically, as soon as somebody connects, it will execute this login routine, and then it will start going through our code. So that's it. I mean, that's pretty simple. It didn't really take a whole lot of code to create a backdoor that is highly effective and is not going to be notified or send an alert via antivirus. So it's really great for a penetration test backdoor. All right, so let's see this baby in action. So I'm going to test this on just this same computer right here because it's just easier for me to do my videos. But this works for a local network. It works for the internet. It works for anything and everything. The only difference is you just need to change your IP with your IP. We're going to pretend this tab right here is my victim, and this tab right here is my attack computer. On your attack computer, you need to have a process that's listening for that remote shell. So we need to use netcat to listen, open a listener on port 443. So I'm going to do that now. All right, so now our attack computer is sitting there and it's waiting for that victim computer to call it. So now let's go to our victim computer. And, you know, somehow on your victim computer, you want them to execute your Python script. So let's go ahead and do that. Now we're going to execute this. All right, perfect. So now our Python script, our backdoor, is running secretly in the background. So now on our attack computer, you can see the victim computer has made a connection. Our program is running, and our Python program on the victim computer is talking to us over the internet right now, and it's asking us, well, what is the password? It says login, but really we're giving it the password. And I think that's good because if anybody found this, they're going to be expecting a login password. And they're never going to get in because they're always most likely going to enter in something wrong because it only needs one piece of information, not two. So anyways, let's go ahead and put in an incorrect password. And you can see that our program knew that it's not the correct password. Re-executed the login script. So you can see we can do this over and over, and this will just happen forever. Okay, so let's go ahead and type in our real password. And you can see now that we were just sent here. It says connected, gave us a prompt, and it executed the shell. So right now, we're basically sitting inside this while loop. And it's just going. And right now, it's actually waiting, sitting right here, waiting for us to type in some data. And it's not going to move on until we type in some data and hit enter. So let's go ahead and execute a command. And look at that. We executed the ID command, and that was returned from our victim computer all the way across the internet to us. See, we are logged in as root, and we can do whatever we want. It's perfect. Our backdoor works. This is great. Success. High five. Celebrate. So lastly, let's just go ahead and test our exit. And there you have it. You can see that we are now exited out of our remote shell. And if you look, our Python script has closed execution. So it's closed on our victim computer as well. There you have it, guys. That's pretty simple and pretty straightforward. Now I want you to expand upon this. There's a lot more you can do with this. You can make this more advanced and just do a lot more, have a lot more capability. So why don't you play with this and do some other stuff with this? And if you come up with anything cool, feel free to share it. Post it in the comments. Send us a link. Well, thanks for watching, guys. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to give me a thumbs up. I do greatly appreciate that. It motivates me to make new videos. Don't forget to subscribe. By subscribing, you'll get notifications to all my new videos. And I greatly appreciate you guys, and I will see you on the other side.